Thanks very much, Vicente, for a very, very interesting presentation and a very useful and important publication, I think. I should add that I'm very interested in Latin America for Latin America, so I would have paid attention to this and I would have found this interesting, even if I had grown convinced at the same time that it just bears no relevance whatsoever for any other part of the world, because I think it very, very persuasively does what you probably set out for yourself to do, which is to make a certain kind of policy argument, which you have identified as important policy priorities for the discussion, the regional discussion, but also the individual political discussions within governments in Latin America, and then just went out and did a tremendous job at collecting all sorts of data that is ultimately going to be useful for people. And that's already my first point for why this is relevant, even if you really don't care one bit about what's happening in Latin America. I think the wealth of data that you can find here and the sort of the inspiration that you can take from this is incredibly useful, just if you're interested in what is the variation, what is the composition of taxes in different countries, what are some of the underlying trends over time and between countries, et cetera, et cetera. And I think the first thing that really struck me about this is already the premise of the book itself, which is an interesting comparison to many other developing countries, where I think for us over the last, I don't know, maybe 10 years or so, probably the dominant debate around taxation is exactly like Francesca mentioned it already. Essentially, taxation as a tool of state building. You want taxation to be successful. You want governments to raise a certain proportion, certainly a larger proportion than the status quo, because it's seen as the key ingredient of what a fiscal state is all about. And I'm sure Mika is going to have more to say about this. Whereas in OECD countries, of course, that's a completely moot point. Most Western European countries pass the 20% threshold of GDP revenue collection probably at the beginning of the 20th century, and today nobody cares anymore about what this means for state building, because the states are already there. And the entire discussion about tax is around its policy implications, mm-hmm. and what sort of a fiscal policy tool is it, what are the effects on obviously on wealth, on inequality, on growth, and all the rest of it. And it seems to me that you're almost trying to move Latin America very squarely into the taxation as policy column and move it further away from the sort of residual concern, which at least in some countries in Latin America might still be, we really don't care where it comes from, mm-hmm. as long as it's something that is going into government coffers, because it's just so little to start with. Mm-hmm. And that sort of intermediate stage where Latin America now finds itself is of course very, very interesting for other regions in the world as well, where maybe you're much, much closer to the sort of initial concern, we wish we were able to somehow get beyond 5% or 10% of GDP. And we take it from wherever we can take it, and the policy implications let that our grandchildren figure out. And I think that alone is already quite an interesting thing. Now, about how well does this travel? How well do your findings travel to other places? I think I'm slightly less sanguine. And the reason is, or I should say the specifics of your findings on your analysis, how well does that travel? And the first point with regards to that is taking me back to the variation within Latin America. Mm-hmm. I mean, we speak about Latin America as a region, and we are pointing out these trends. Revenue collection overall is going up, inequality overall is going down at least slightly. Latin America as a region, of course, had a pretty decent growth record over the last decade, but all of that is hiding massive amounts of variation within the region. And that is between countries like Brazil, for instance, where I'm sure the Brazilians would basically say, if it was possible, we wish that the overall tax burden was a little bit less, because it's there in OECD territory where people also think overall that it's probably enough as it is. Whereas if you look at countries like Mexico, which is of course also it's an OECD member country, but if you take out the oil sector and everything that is related to Pemex and all that stuff, it's basically not raising any taxes at all. And doesn't seem to be particularly bothered about raising taxes. And so these sorts of differences between countries in Latin America, and that's not even going into the sort of the size difference between the Brazils and the, I don't know, the Nicaraguas, or the income differences between the Nicaraguas and the Panamas and Costa Ricas. That means that what applies to one country doesn't necessarily apply to another country. It's facilitated by language, geographical proximity, and all the rest of it. But it doesn't necessarily mean that it goes over well in one place just because it went over well in another place. And I think that is the message that for us is really, really important to bear in mind, because I think the wrong takeaway from this relatively positive story that we are finding here is, if it worked in Latin America, then why can't you do it, Ghana? Or why can't you do it, Mozambique? Or why can't you do it, India? Or whichever country you happen to be picking, which you happen to be picking out. Because that difference between what I think is a very reasonable assumption to make is the sort of the revenue potential given a certain income level or a certain degree of development, and the actual revenues that you are able to raise is probably not just due to lack of skill and capacity and information about how to best organize your revenue collection system. And I'm just thinking of things like, you know, like turning your revenue collection into semi-independent agencies, creating performance incentive schemes for revenue collection, setting up large taxpayer units, which are sort of the staples of technical assistance for revenue administration reform, where almost all countries in Latin America have done these things. Many of them have done them very successfully, at least in the short run. And in part, that is why you're finding this increasing revenue collection trend over time. But of course, if you go to another country which is less wealthy, which has a large informal sector, and you're saying, let's set up a large taxpayer unit here, the largest 50 taxpayers, if you are the commissioner of revenues, those are probably people you know, because you went to school with them. Mm-hmm. And if they are quite capable of doing their own tax incidence analysis when some revenue collection changes are on the horizon, and they will pick up the phone and tell you that this is not going to be something that is politically viable, or that they are just, their kids are not going to talk to your kids anymore, and therefore you better think twice before you go about doing these sorts of things. And so there are hard institutional and political limits to some of these changes. And I think the question that I was really left with here at the end, and that I think is a debate that, I mean, I would be very interested to hear from what you find about this within Latin America, but I think also for us collectively what this means globally, is to what extent are you able as a country to escape the trajectory that you are on anyway as a function of development? Mm-hmm. So if you have a certain growth rate and you're moving from low income to middle income, does that mean that almost by default you're also going to be able to raise more revenues as your collection capacity and your administrative capacity increases? These issues of all of a sudden you can use expenditures as instruments of redistribution, and you maybe have to worry less about the regressiveness of the revenue collection because those expenditure programs actually work. They're not being lost due to inefficiency or corruption or whatever. And you can make those policy choices. But if you're really, really poor and your administrative capacity is bad, if your analytical capacity is bad, and if there's not much to tax with to begin with, then there's not much that you can do about it. But the question that I'm asking myself is, are you able to jump ahead? If you did like a really, really dedicated, very, very professional, state-of-the-art revenue administration reform, would that allow you to jump ahead of the curve? Mm-hmm. Or would everything that surrounds revenue administration efforts basically just catch you and take you down so that you're back at the average? And the same would be, of course, for, you know, if you are a natural resource-dependent economy and all of a sudden you decided, let's tax our citizens anyway, even though we are doing okay because of all the oil. Is that something that would be politically feasible? Would you be able to somehow figure out how to use that as a lever to get other changes going? Or is that just not something that... Do we even have evidence of these sorts of things ever working out? And I'm asking this fairly innocently because I know far more about public expenditures than I do about revenue. So I'm genuinely curious to know what these stories are. But I think that would be a conversation very, very worthwhile. And I'm going to leave it at that.
Thank you very much. Essentially scribbling furiously, so we'll have plenty of time to come back. But I think we want to load a little bit more on still. Mick, apologies that we've been very rude and let our sort of internal go first, but on the other hand, it gives people the opportunity to pick up immediately on what you say. So,
okay, thank you, Ed.